I don't know what they told you, but just to remind you, when I give a call to Professor Parisi, we'll go down so we can watch the
time. Yeah.
Okay, so you should have the.
So ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Welcome everybody to this special ICTP CISSA colloquium. We are glad to welcome today Professor Giorgio Parisi and take this opportunity to congratulate him on his Nobel Prize. This is in fact Professor Parisi's first scientific talk after he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics 2021 on October 5. And both ICTP and CISSA are honored and grateful that Professor Parisi chose to be here today with all of us here in the room and also with all the broader scientific community connected online through Zoom. We will start now with a welcome message by ICTP's director, Atish Dabholkar, followed by an introduction by Professor Ruffo, the director of CISSA. Then we'll give the floor to Professor Parisi for his lecture. So now I leave the floor to Professor Dabholkar.
Thank you. So it's a great pleasure for me to welcome all of you to this very nice ceremony. It was good to see this very warm ovation, almost like an encore in a musical concert. So maybe it was an encore for a second Nobel Prize. So it's a special pleasure for ICTP and for all of us in theoretical physics to welcome Giorgio to this colloquium today. He has made deep and far-reaching contributions to really a diverse topics in theoretical physics, ranging from evolution equations of constituents of nuclear matter to the physics of complex systems. In fact, I encountered his work on supersymmetric matrix models, the Marinari-Parisi model, as a postdoc in the field of string theory and quantum gravity. And I think this remarkable breadth of his scientific oeuvre, I would say, has the kind of open-ended quality which is reminiscent of the great Renaissance physicist Enrico Fermi in the finest traditions of Italian physics. And his contributions were recognized by this prestigious Dirac Medal in 1919. Awarded by ICTP, and he has strong connections with researchers at ICTP and also CISSA. And I'm also very looking forward to the title of his talk is quite intriguing. I think there is a famous book by Poincaré with the same title called the La Valeur de la Science. And there is a very marvelous essay by Feynman, again with the same title. So I'm looking forward to what Giorgio has to say about this topic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Dabholkar. Now I leave the floor to CISSA's director, Professor Stefano Ruffo, who will make an introduction to Professor Parisi and an overview of his research and scientific career. So please, Professor Roux.
Thank you. And can you hear? Giorgio Parisi is an exceptionally deep thinker. During his career, he has given seminal contributions in many different areas of physics and beyond, from particle physics to computer simulation, from the theory of turbulence to the statistical physics topics. He received, as you all know, the 2021 Nobel Prize in Physics for the discovery of the interplay of disorder and fluctuations in physical systems from atomic to planetary scales, with an overarching citation for groundbreaking contributions to our understanding of complex physical systems. Quite remarkably, he shared the Nobel Prize with Klaus Hasselmann and Shukuro Manabe for the physical modeling of the Earth's climate, quantifying variability and reliably predicting global warming, so which is a very hot topic for all humanity now. It is difficult to summarize Parisi's achievements. I will first focus on one of them, the Parisi solution of spin glass. He proposed his replica symmetry breaking method that solved the Sherrington-Kirkpatrick model for spin glasses in 1979, opening the way to the study of new class of phase transitions that are different from the usual Landau-Wilson class and also different from another big class of the Berezinski-Kostelitz-Taules. In this new class, where ergodicity is broken in an infinite number of states unrelated by symmetry, without prior information about an order parameter, the replica symmetry breaking method separates phase space in ergodic components and gives information on the relative location of these components on the energy hypersurface. This breakthrough opened the way to applications in neural network theories that are, remember, the Amit Gutfreund-Sompolinsky solution of the Hopfield model, with an impact on the foundations of machine learning, a very, very up-to-date topic nowadays. In combinatorial optimization, the analytic calculation of the satisfiability threshold of the KSAT problem with Mesar and Zecchina, and recently has allowed an exact description of structural glasses in the limit of infinite dimensions, a research area in which Giorgio is very active nowadays. I would like to briefly mention also his main contribution to particle physics, the Altarelli-Parisi equations, which is not cited in the Nobel document, but for which he received other important prizes, notably the extremely prestigious 2021 Wolf Prize for groundbreaking discoveries in disordered systems, particle physics, and statistical physics. In 1973, well before the 1977 paper with Altarelli, Giorgio started the phenomenological study of scaling violations in deep inelastic scattering in a field theoretic framework. This study culminated in the formulation with Altarelli of the so-called Dokshitzer-Gripov-Lipatov-Altarelli-Parisi equations for the evolution of the parton densities. These equations are at the basis of all perturbative quantum chromodynamics calculations that have been recently verified with very high accuracy at the Large Hadron Collider in the same experiments where the Higgs boson has been discovered. Besides these two major achievements, there is a countless list of pioneering contributions by Giorgio Parisi to physics, which are exceptional both in depth and in breadth. I might simply list some of them: stochastic quantization without gauge fixing, planar diagrams, and the one-dimensional supersymmetric string that also Atish was mentioning, bosonization of fermions in lattice gate theories, perturbative expansion at fixed dimension to compute critical exponent at phase transitions, supersymmetry and dimensional reduction in disordered systems, multifractal models of turbulence, stochastic resonance, the Kardar-Parisi-Zhang equation for growing interface. I would like to mention that Zhang, I checked with Giorgio this morning, was a CISA PhD student. And he was clearly very smart because he soon understood who were the right person to work with arriving in Trieste. Elastic manifolds in random media, collective animal motion. Let us also mention hardware construction. Maybe not many of you know, but Giorgio with Nicola Cabibbo was the proponent and the scientific coordinator of the APE project in the 80s, and he was directly involved in the design and of both software and hardware of a family of parallel computers dedicated to the calculation of the mass spectrum in lattice gauge theories. His impact in statistical physics is comparable only to the one of Kenneth Wilson, Nobel Prize in Physics 1982. All this qualifies Giorgio Parisi as a universal thinker, a Renaissance scientist, as Atish was saying. Concerning Parisi's relation to CIS, I would like to mention that he served as the chair of the International Scientific Advisory Committee, and some of his numerous master students from Rome did their PhD at CISA, and he continued in recent times to co-advise CISA PhD students and postdocs. Now I will finish from the document highlighting the scientific background of the 2021 Nobel Prize in Physics. I read, "We recognize that scientists understand that no single prediction of anything can be taken as unassailable truth, and that without understanding the origins of variability, we cannot understand the behavior of any system." I think this sentence can serve as an introduction of today's lecture by Giorgio on the value of science.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Ruffo. Now it is time to leave the floor to Professor Parisi for his talk on the value of science. So please, Professor Parisi, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for these very wonderful introductions. And let me start with my colloquium on the science, on the value of science. Now, different people, okay, I can take out, sorry. Different people had a different opinion. One of the most extreme position, but it's very well synthesized, was done by Richard Feynman. Richard Feynman, all physicists know who it was. He was a wonderful stellar physicist, which won, of course, the Nobel Prize, and was considered one of the greatest physicists of the second half of the previous century, and is certainly the most sympathetic one. He was used to play bongo and so on. He's a great sense of humor, and he says that science is like sex. Science, as both of them, science and sex, have practical consequences. But most of the time, the practical consequences are not the reasons for which we do it. So, this sentence, let me, I'm not able to translate. The Dante thinks fatti non foste per vivere come bruti ma per seguire virtù de conoscenza. Sorry, not well. It was an imperative by Dante that says that men and women are not done by not created for living like beasts, but you have to follow the virtue and knowledge. And this was something that Dante said about what people should do. And now this statement by Feynman reflects very well the subjective position of the scientist, the subject positions, how they see themselves. Now it's clear that science is a normal puzzle. And every piece of this puzzle that is put in the right place, each tessera is something like a tessera of a mosaic, allow you the possibility of putting other one. Therefore, this way is something like a gigantic, mosaic, and each scientist add some kind, a new tessera, a new piece, and someone is lucky one that is will add the tessera of the eyes, where all people will look around, but he can put the tessera of the eyes because other people put the tessera of the dresses and so on. And what is nice in this kind of building, that everybody know that he has done a contribution, and also when after some time the name will be forgotten, there will be other people that will arrive that will use his result. And has been said by many people, we go on his shoulder to see far away. So science is a collective endeavor that needs cooperation. Science without cooperation is dead, because you discover something, you die, your discovery is forgotten. So it's clear that science is just a huge cooperative enterprise done by the whole humanity. And also science is very interesting, that is in some sense, as far as I understand, is a never-ending enterprise. Let me try to do a metaphor of the scientific enterprise. Let's say that some people arrive in the night on an unknown island, and there are no light, no moon, and so on, and they put on a fire on the beach. With the fire, you start to see something, and you understand more what is on the island. But you start to see that there are some black regions of the island that you don't understand. You just barely see there's something, but you don't know. Now you can put more wood on the fire. The fire becomes bigger and bigger, more bright and bright. And now you start to see more. Many more things, more wood you put on the fire, more things you see, but more things you see, you discover that the island is bigger and there are other things that you can just barely see that you don't see. Therefore, this happens more and more. And more you put light, more you discover there's something that you don't know. And this is the same things for science. More we explore the universe, more we know that the new regions of exploring. And each discovery not only allows us to answer to old questions, but to formulate new questions. And before new questions that before that discovery, we could not be able to formulate. Let me think to a relatively recent example. People knew from astronomy that there were some spots on the sky, that something like a nebula and so on, but it was not clear the origin. At a certain moment, they discovered that there were galaxies, because they could see some of the stars and so on. Now, it's clearly that this discovery has as answered to the nature of the nebula that you can see, but open an infinite many huge number of questions, which are the galaxy, which are the property of the galaxy, and so on. And therefore, this means that science is a never-ending exploration. But beyond this kind of consideration, I think that for scientists, for most of the scientists, it's fundamental that there should be amusing to solve the puzzle. My mentor, Nicola Cabibbo, was always saying, when we were discussing physics, why should we study this problem if we do not amuse ourselves in doing it? Sometimes, especially when I was young, there was some kind of surprise that we were paid for doing something that we would like to do. That usually you are not paid for what you want to do, but doing a scientist, you are paid for what you do. And my good friend, unfortunately, died, Aurelio Grillo, always was saying, to be a physicist is a hard work, is strong, is quite tiring, but it's always better than to work. In reality, it's written in the following, because it takes something, if you do something that you like to do, you can remain in the night up in 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock working, and you don't feel the tiredness instead, because it's you that you want to do. You have to remember unless the very rare cases in which a scientist was a rich man and the research was done in the period where the rich men had not worked. I'm thinking of Fermat, I'm thinking of Plinius the Old. The scientist had always a problem that he has also to eat, has to find to eat. And the application of science has been always important in order to eat while doing science. And you have to think to one of the first science in the astronomy. It's difficult. Now we live in cities which are well illuminated by electric lights. But if you think of primitive civilization, where the amount of light of fire in the night was in the street was very low, the effect of the power, the prestige of those which were to control the season, to have when winter started and so on, that they controlled the movement of the stars, of the planet, and they can be predicted as eclipses. They can be predicted the eclipses of moon, which is already an extraordinary event if you are not cultivated, if you don't know astronomy. And also you could predict this terrifying phenomena, which is the eclipses of sun. You have to understand that eclipses of sun, if you don't know, may throw people in terror. And if somebody could tell you, don't worry, there will be eclipse of sun, I will stop when I will move my hand, the eclipses will stop, and so on. This was very important for the power. And it's clearly that the people that were doing science got prestige for these things. The power, the government were paying for their life in order to these things. So the astronomy was, in some sense, the first applied science, although we think astronomy to be only pure science. At the beginning, astronomy was an important science. And the motivation of the people, the mecenates, were not only culture, but sometimes were for having prestige, but ever the scientists knew the importance of the practical applications. For example, Galileo, you know, that discovered the Galilean planet, the Medicei planet around Jupiter. And you know that this planet at a certain moment they go behind Jupiter and they cannot be seen. The time at which this happens can be predicted very easily by the law of physics of that time. And therefore the idea of Galileo that you could use this occultation of the planets by Jupiter as a watch, as a clock, as a universal clock that may be used in all parts of the world and could be used to synchronize clock in South America with the clock in Europe. And now the synchronization of the clock is fundamental because of the problem of computing the longitude. And that was very difficult to compute. The problem, the proposal of Galileo was not sufficient and practical. And after the solution was solved with a clock, real clock watch. However, that was, and with the aim of coordinating scientific research, in 1617, there have been founded many academies which dominated the role still, the Académie Lincei, the Royal Society, l'Académie des Sciences, l'American Philosophical Society in 1743. The American Philosophical Society was founded by Benjamin Franklin with the aim of promoting useful knowledge. However, with going on times, science became always more useful to society. And nowadays, the economic development is based on scientific progress, not only nowadays, from the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, but the science, especially in these days, become more cost, need more money, bigger resources, and an organization which is much more complex. The Second World War, science, the beginning of mass science, because and not only with Los Alamos that you know, but with all problem of world need of machine and so on was crucial. And Vannevar Bush coordinated the effort of 6,000 scientists. And okay, now the science, which institution needed to be financed by society. And I think that society does not care at all if scientists amuse themselves or not. This point of view has been expressed in a very clear way from the Soviet delegation to the Congress of History of Science and Technology that happened in London in 1931. Bukharin, that probably someone remember, was one of the leaders of the Russian Revolution that unfortunately died during Stalin Purg. He was very popular in the Soviet Union, the type, wrote that the idea that the science as aims to itself, internal view of the science, is naive. This idea mixed the subjective pulsions of the science of the professional scientist that works in a system where the work is very strongly divided with the role, the objective social role of this kind of activities and this objective role is an activity with utmost practical importance. Now, it's clearly that it's not possible to think of the technology as the development without an advancement of pure science. In the book of L'Arte dell'Architetto of 1977, science, pure science, not only give to the applied science the needed knowledge to develop language, metaphor, conceptual framework, but as a role more hidden and not less important, indeed, the scientific activity of BASE works as some kind of very large circuit in order to test a new product, develop a new product, technological product, and they are some first place where high advanced technology is used. Now, the point that science and technique are so well integrated, may think that the science will have a wonderful future in a society that becomes always more dependent by the advanced technology. However, if you give a look around, you see that you are starting to have some problem. Indeed, you have problems that of different kind. The prestige of science is sometimes is decreasing. There are strong anti-scientific tendency in our society. Well, not so strong, but they have a certain weight, and you can see also here. And some trust in science is decreasing with the time. And as you start to have some, not only people that come back to astrology, to homeopathy, and you have anti-scientist position. For example, you can see Novax, you can see all the story about Xylella in South Italy, and also the biodynamics agriculture that is what should be approved, I hope not, by law of state. And it's amusing that it's this kind of anti-scientific position, let's say, diffuse themselves together with a very angry consumistic idea of consuming product AI technology. I mean, most of the people have a very, very smartphone. This smartphone is some condensate, incredible condensate of technology and so on. But having a smartphone does not forbid the people to make anti-scientific statement. And it's not easy to understand really the origin of this phenomenon. However, as scientists and also citizenship of our country, it's clear that at least myself, maybe I hope also you don't like this phenomenon or these anti-scientific positions. Because this anti-scientific position, the end I damage for the whole society. But however, if you want to fight something, you have first to understand the deep roots. If you don't understand the deep roots for something, it is clear that you cannot put no remedy if you don't know the cause. Now one could say that it's possible that this starting of this untrust, missing trust in the science can be done from the fact that the scientists are not sometimes too present in an arrogant way. They sometimes they are antipathic when they speak. And they try to present science as absolute knowledge and respect to all other knowledge that that can be discussed. They present also when there are some scientific positions that are not completely sure. And for example, therefore they have some way, I mean, it's clearly that if you have if someone sees the television, that there are two people. One is sympathetic, one is antipathetic, you believe to the sympathetic one. And if the scientist is the television is antipathetic, no matter what he says, it may be perfectly right, but the result is negative. I speak on arrogance because sometimes you try to have, you don't try to have to show to the proof, to the public, the proof that you have of something, but you ask to the public to believe in an unconditional trust in an expert. Now, just the need, just the fact that sometimes the scientists do not accept their limits. I mean, there are many things that the scientists do not know, but it's very hard to hear in a public talk to some scientists say, no, that I don't know. I mean, you have to understand that you have limits this acknowledgement of the limit that may limit the prestige of scientists. Sometimes they are too safe on something which is on which you should not so safe, and sometimes the public opinion is in reality very good in realize the limiting of the scientists and they understand the partiality of what they say. And also there is another point that there are people that are doing present science in a bad way, and science is presented as some kind of wizardry. I mean, what is a wizardry? I mean, think of the old wizardry. You move something, and something transforms in something else. For example, like in many fairy tales. Sometimes, therefore, the results are presented in such a way that you cut all the things intermediate, and you discover this as a wizardry, more or less. And now, because you cut all intermediate steps, and now this is, and also something is done for the publicity, also to get publicity, some kind of propaganda. We had many times in news or newspaper a big discovery for medicine that ends nothing, or may appear on the market in 20 years and so on. And so this way that the scientists do present themselves as a propaganda, doing a propaganda to get money, to impress the public to get support. And they present things like a wizardry cutting the intermediate stage. This is very dangerous because someone that is not a scientist may be driven into an irrational position in front of a science that is also perceived as a wizardry. Therefore to prefer to science something that is also irrational, that is clearly rational. This has been discussed a long time ago by a wonderful book of Marco Teron, L'Ape l'Architetto. But in a nutshell, if science became a pseudo-wizardry, why don't choose the original wizardry and not an imitation of the wizardry? I mean, and I don't say that science is an imitation of wizardry, but the way that sometimes is presented looks that way. So we have we have to do something something different in this situation. We have to do something different in this situation. And there is also important things that we should take care, that we should not have confidence on the fact that if they need the technology, science will go on. We know that in the past, where things were not this way. The Romans had taken the technological science from Greece, but they taken the technology, sorry, the Romans had taken from technology, the technology from Greece, but they had not taken science from Greece. Science during the Roman time disappeared. And also we have to remember that later on, the Christians killed Hypatia, and they did not care at all of the consequences of long term of killing the mathematicians. On the other hand, they were happy of the disappearance of some knowledge that was considered useful and dangerous. And also we must careful that before we have this kind of possibility of disappearing of science, maybe not disappearing science of all the countries, but we may have disappearance of the science in some countries. And therefore the future of science in Italy is something that is something for which we have to fight. It's not something that we have taken to granted. We have to remember that Italy has had a very strong decline of technological. And what happened in Italy, we have a deindustrialization, I mean, the decrease of the industrialization in Italy. And we remember, you saw from the 60s, there had been the killing of Mattei. There was a people that were did Marotta, that did a factory for producing penicillin in Italy, that was arrested. Not for putting the factory, but it was something that was stopping this. The Benedetti, when the Benedetti died, all electronics that was developed by the Benedetti industry, just not the Benedetti. Olivetti things when Olivetti died. The first microcomputer, microchips for computer were produced in Italy. And therefore, we have all the type of disappearance, the selling of big part of our pharmaceutics to outside and taking the farm outside. So Italy had a very strong decrease of technological capabilities. And it's possible that also without an industry of this type, if we don't do a strong investment, also science is going to disappear to Italy, and we will come with something very near to the third world. And now you will see that we have in Italy, we have a slow decay of public school. We have a strong disinvestment of the government in what you can call cultural goods. For example, the restoration of the Colosseum, that is very important, was paid by private funds because the state did not put money to restore the Colosseum. And the money that was given to for cinema from state for quality cinema is decreasing, and the thing that it decreased from 20 years more than a factor two, in spite that cinema in Italy was a very important cultural asset. Of course, it's still a cultural asset, but it's not so much cultivated by state. And we see that we have a low decrease of all cultural activities in Italy, and sometimes also in other points. Now, the things that we need, that we have to defend the culture in Italy and the rest of the world, and also we have to avoid, to lose our ability to transmit culture to the new generation. And that is something that is very important. It's very important that culture and science are not two things that are separated, but are two faces of the same coin. And also, it's quite important that we defend science not only for those practical aspects, but also for the cultural value. I mean, I remember very well a very important man, Robert Wilson, that was one of the founding of Accelerator in the United States. And he was one of the planning to build the big accelerator of Fermilab at Batavia in Illinois. That was an extremely important step for the physics. And he went to the Senate, and the American Senate asked him which are the applications of the construction of the accelerator. Now, he had two choices. Start to discuss, well, we can do this with the accelerator may be useful for construct, for studying material and so on. We study the protons are important because everything is done by protons or things like that. And he gave an answer which was very, I think it's a wonderful answer. And it says that no, this accelerator is not useful for the industry. It's not useful for defend our country. It's not useful for doing new arms and so on. This was a question that was asked, but the value of this accelerator is in the love for culture. It is like a painting, like sculpture, like poetry, like all those activities that we Americans are like as in a patriotic way. We are proud of this activity in a good patriotic mood. It does not need to defend our country, but it makes it is such that it is worthwhile to defend our country. So it's clear that this is some kind of defense of science and defense on culture. And something that we have to say, because in this period, not only we have problem with science and with culture. And if we need to present science as culture, we have to make the population as far as we can understand what is the science, how science is done. I think that we realized, especially during the COVID, how you arrive consensus. Because one of the things that I see many, many times of people saying, well, there's one paper that says something, but one paper is part of science, but it's not the response of science. The response of science, where the scientists are convinced that the paper is right, they reproduce the paper, they discuss the paper, they found the weak point, they correct the weak points. So science is a collective endeavor, it's not one paper. So presenting one paper, and that is something that we do not understand. People do not understand, and therefore we needed to present science and culture. Our science and culture are connected one with the other. We have to present which has been the historical development of science and culture, and how consensus, which is important things of science, is formed. How does this formation of consensus is a really democratic way between the people that understand scientists. We have to explain in a way that does not appear to my magic what do scientists, which are the things that we understand. And that is very difficult. It's very difficult, especially for scientists like the one like physics, where you get a lot of mathematics. Eva, we always say that our science cannot be understood who has not studied mathematics. But the same things we could say for science poetry, which could not be understood for those which do not know Chinese. Indeed, if you look to Chinese poetry, this is something that cannot be translated because it's a mixture of literature and painting. I mean, no one care, or maybe someone care, of the original manuscript of Leopardi on L'Infinito. But no one thinks that reading the original manuscript of Leopardi, you get a better understanding of Leopardi poetry. Now, on the other hand, the original manuscript, the unique manuscript of a Chinese poetry is what counts. And when you, in many cases, when we produce the poetry, you reproduce the characters, the writing of the author, because the writing of the author is a picture, is a painting. And therefore it is something that you cannot really appreciate if you don't know the Chinese. However, Chinese poetry are translated into Italian. You lose some of the original value, but you get some idea that you can appreciate Chinese. Therefore, in the same way, you could be able to have an appreciation of mathematics or mathematics things, also if you're not a mathematician. But Eva, I have to add something that is more difficult, not more difficult, it's something for which it's not so easy to find the solutions. That I believe that the difficulties that there are in this with science, with some fortunately small part of the society, but it depends on the country, have a more deep origin. And this deep origin, they have to understand well in order to control them. Now, we all understand that we are in a period of pessimism on the future. I mean, the future is not seen as something concerning brilliant. We have a crisis of various nations. We have economic crisis. We have a climate crisis. We have the crisis due to the end of resources. I mean, we are not using renewable resources, and non-renewable resources are near to the end. We have a huge increase of pollutions. And we have also in certain countries an increase of inequalities, not always. we have in our country the precariato, I mean, the fact that young people do not have a permanent job, which was completely different. We have an increase of unemployment. We have a lot of war that have not stopped after the Second War, and I think that something like 50 million or 100 million people died of war after the second one. I'm not checked this number, but I think that they are more or less correct. And now, you see, once upon the time, everybody was thinking that the future will be better than the present. However, that is not anymore true. People will have a strong fear that the future may be worse than the present. And now the trust in the progress, the trust in what Leopardi was calling the magnifica e progressive sortio umana gente, I mean the idea that we are going always toward a better situation, is no more valid. Many people fear the future generation will be worse than the present generation. I think that this is a sociological fact. I don't say that these kind of fears are founded. Some of them are well-founded, climate change and so on. But I think that if we something that we move, if we use science, we can stop. However, at once upon the time, science had the merit of the progress, because everybody says electric light and so on due to science and so on. And now science, in some sense, have the envy of the fact that now there is a decline. I mean, I don't say that the decline is due to science or there is a real decline, but there is a perceived decline. And in some senses, science, in the same way that was responsible for the growth, for the fact the situation was better, is considered in some sense responsible of the decline. Maybe something that's not said in an explicit way, but the thing that makes a part of the mood. And I mean, science sometimes is considered to be a bad teacher, which considers the humanity in the wrong direction. And this perception is not easy. We cannot go in the street and say we are good teacher, not bad teacher. We have to do something else. And there is, you see with all elections, the election of Trump and many other elections, there's a big unsatisfaction in the public, which could show up in both people that vote against everybody that carried the humanity in this present position, in this present of crisis, and the scientists do not escape to this negative procedure. Now, it's clear that it's not easy what we should do. We have certain, we stay in a very difficult situation. And first of all, I think that one of the things that is important, is very important that scientists are honest with themselves. I mean, they are usually honest when they speak of scientific things, but they must be honest also in realizing all these type of aspects and try to speak with the people. And also there should be a more important, more effort to teach science in the school. This is very important to teach science in the school, because science is, if you teach, learn something in the school, you learn for all the life. But ever, the way that unfortunately is teached this science is teached in the school nowadays is not an optimal one. is something which science is presented as an accomplished fact. But what is in science is not so much as accomplished fact, but is the trajectory in which science has been produced. It's the act of doing science that is important. It's not the result. In the same way of the metaphor by Feynman at the beginning. Therefore you have to explain, if you want to explain how science is done, you have to have the children to do science by themselves, to do discoveries by themselves. And that can be done. That can be done also from the school of, from the kindergarten, elementary school, and so on. And this was the essence of the method of Maria Montessori, the great Italian educator, whose face was put on the banknote of 1,000 lire, but the method had been partially forgotten, part of the method forgotten. And what is important is that what the teacher should prepare for the pupils, for the children, is some very well prepared setting, some well prepared environment, and once they should be stimulated to do this, but after the child should explore what they have to see, the experiment they have to do, with their pace, with giving all them all the time they need, because if you discover something by yourself, this is 1,000 times more valuable than someone else teach to you. So one thing that we have to do is to change drastically the way that science is teached. I mean, no practical, no school, maybe a few one in school, also for a liceo, for high school, a scientific school, is organized in the way that people can do experiment in the school, not seeing the experiment done by the teacher, but they do the experiment by themselves. Therefore, we have to do a very strong effort. We have to do a very strong effort to change the way that science is taught, to involve the children in this kind of activities. This is something that will be done out in some countries. There's a wonderful movement, Men à la Pète, ends in the pace that was done, I think, by Charpak and many other people in France, and that is something that is very important. There are other type of initiative. Of course, there are the things that we have to do, construct a museum of science, where people can have meet themselves. Rome is the city which is the only big capital of Europe, I guess, which doesn't have a museum of science. So we have to do a lot of things. And that comes also to the responsibility of scientists. It's clearly that a part of the things is a duty of the politicians due to the fact that some decisions should be politically given. But if the scientists themselves do not push for a change in teaching of science, do not push from every museum in science, do not push from a presentation of science to the public in such a way that the people in the public can follow in a clear way, and they do not push for non-magic presentation of science. It's clear if this is not done by scientists, it will certainly no one else will do. So I think that as scientists, we have a huge responsibility, not only to go on with science, to do what we should do in various fields of science to move science in the direction of doing something useful. For example, something that is good for contrasting the climate change, without neglecting, of course, of basic science, because many times the discovery comes from an incomplete and unexpected way. But we have to move in this direction. And if things do not happen, we cannot say that is not our fault. Okay, thank you.
So, thank you again, Professor Parisi, for a wonderful talk. It was nice to see a full hall today, and we had more than 700 people connected online, both on Zoom and YouTube and Facebook. So thank you again for helping us disseminate in science, especially with younger physicists that will hopefully build a future community of great scientists. So now it is time for some questions. So please feel free to ask questions again, both here in the room or through Zoom. The Q&A session will be moderated by Professor Dabolkar and by Professor Matteo Marsili for the questions on Zoom. So I leave the floor to Q&A. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for this wonderful talk, Giorgio. And we have time for a few questions.
Yes, please.
Maybe there.
Hello, Carlo Pacigalupi, Sissa. You are in a location in which politicians made strategic investments for placing international institutions in an area which was a border between two different systems. Do you think that scientists and science institutions are still up to the task, and which barrier can we break today?
Well, to break barrier in science, a barrier from different fields, is something difficult. And of course, any type of effort is welcome. For example, well, in Accademia dei Lincei, where I belong, we have two different classes, and we have a lot of discussion among people, the scientists and humanists. What I was told, that do not belong to, that the Istituto Veneto, there is really interdisciplinary discussion on everything. So Bavia maybe go down, but one has to do an effort, because it's like destroying walls. If you find a wall and you don't destroy it, it separates always people from one side to the other side.
Okay, there is one question over there.
So Andrea Gambassi, Sissa. So you trace back the mistrust in science to the scientists presenting science as an ultimate truth, right? So like you said, the problem is, what about instead when the scientists go in TV shows and they start debating in, I would say, quite a depressing way on scientific themes on the TV shows. And then, you know, this also create mistrust. Sometimes this, what is the basic engine of science becomes the basic engine of mistrust in science, because they don't know to whom they should believe, in a sense. Okay.
Okay. However, let's say the behavior, this type of discussion in television and being somewhat a disaster. And I think that it's not only the fault of the scientists, which have their responsibility, but also the people that organize in the program, because they clearly, if they put together two scientists that they agree with themselves, the audience will be smaller. And if put scientists which try to quarrel, they are more interested. And I think they considered something that was extremely, say, well done in a very bad way, all these things, because if you have to have two people, two scientists, speak about one subject, the natural things will become 1 hour in advance. Discuss about with yourself, clear one to the other your opinion, and after that you understand what the other was saying, you can go on and having you have a more wonderful, simple discussion. I mean, I had the experience. For example, personally, I have experience with Bassetti. We had a discussion because Bassetti was saying that all the decrease in England was due to vaccination. I want to say, no, the beginning of the decrease was not due to vaccination because they were not vaccinated at that time. And the second part of the quiz that is very important was useful to vaccination. We have not been able to understand each other in front of the public, because when you stay in front of the public, you speak for having the public understand what you say, not the other to understand your attempts and so on. And I think that all this discussion that I had with Bassetti would be not present if we had the time to exchange, to see, look, I compute the derivative here of this curve, the slope, and so on, and discuss on the numbers. But if you don't have discussion of before, it's clear that it's a mess. And also, you have to understand that scientists, I am not easy people. I mean, they start to fight one with another one in Congress, and if the survey conferences of 27, or with all discussion between Bohr and Einstein, will be on prime time on the televisions, it's clear that people had a good, a very bad opinion of scientists. And however, they were not on prime time of the revision. Scientists discussed and take some time to form consensus. And the point is that in this case, you had to show people on the television before consensus was formed. And that was a disaster, plus a certain attitude of some scientists to play as a prima donna.
Okay, maybe we can take one question now from the.
Yeah, there is a question from Matteo Secli. He asks, what do you think about the numerological evaluation of scientific merit we are facing more and more, such as the importance given to evaluation of H index and the likes? Do you think it has led to a commodification of science?
Well, I think that numerology is one of the 10 different instruments that can be used to evaluate. I mean, first, all numerology does not make sense if you do not apply in a restricted field. When you apply in a restricted field, it may give some importance, it may give some, sorry, what say that a numerology is some, give you some information. That means if you know that a given paper in a given field has been quoted 100 times, another paper has been quoted 10 times, and the first approximation tells you that the paper has been quoted 100 times is as likely to add more impact on the field, unless the people forgotten to quote the first paper. But I mean, it gives some information. You have to, when you have to make a judgment, is some kind of information that must be complemented to other things. Now, numerology is something that maybe also there are different places where it could be used. One place, if you have to consider the whole department, the average the average activity on the department, is numerology is a fast way to get a result. Of course, numerology should never be used if you want to, therefore, if you want to evaluate a department of 30 people, you can do the numerology. You may do mistake in one direction, mistake in the other direction, the mistakes do cancels. If you have to evaluate someone for a position, you should not do. You look to numerology just to get to see how this guy reflects with other scientists, but you should not use in a serious way numerology. So numerology in for something to get what to say in Italian, the habilitation to be, the statement that you are apt to become full professor, numerology should not be used or used in much, much less way than is now. And also, if you want to call someone, you should not use numerology and so on. Is some fast way to discuss, to see people that in case that you do not have time to look to everything can be used, but of course it should not be used on individuals or at minimum.
Okay, there is one question over there.
Hello, this is Audia from ICTP. The value of science is strongly connected to communication. I mean, the way we communicate science, and at least in Italy, I mean, the Italian experience has clearly shown two big failures. I don't know whether this is from the science or from the society viewpoint. I mean, we've seen that the example of L'Aquila earthquake was a science communication issue. There was a big failure in this. And then recently we've seen also the pandemics. And is there anything that we should really rethink in the way we natural scientists basically talk to the society? And is there any way to rethink new curricula between natural and social sciences by which we could help society evolve at the same speed where science is evolving? So to avoid that the future will be a bad one for society as science keeps evolving. I mean, the future for science will be always better, right? While for society, it seems like there is a failure on our side.
Well, I think that something that we have seen also in the pandemics is in fact that the scientists sometimes are not good to communicate, and they communicate badly. So I think that there should be some professional figure that are also scientists, but more inclined to do communications, in order to communicate in a better way. Because, I mean, I notice a few times people doing a conference and so on, And then I take notice that sometimes they use a technical word that everybody will understand in a different way. And that is a mess because people that even do not understand. For example, mistakes that's done by often by mathematician and also by physicists is to use the word discrete in the sense to something that's done by finite number or element or a separable number or element. Even if you speak with in a conference with layman people and you see the discrete value, they do not understand what you do you mean. They understand discrete like in the new common sense. Therefore, it's a big effort to communicate to people. And this is a mess with especially in the period of COVID. In Germany, Drosten has spent a lot of time doing every week an half hour video, wonderful done, explain the situation. This video has been seen millions of times, and that was a good way to communicate. But to do good communication, it takes time.
Okay.
It takes effort.
Okay. Matteo, maybe one last question from, if there is one.
No, there is no question on the chat.
From the, maybe, okay. Anybody else? Any? Okay, maybe I will ask one question to Giorgio. You made two important points about science, namely the importance of community to arrive at a consensus, which is very important to science, and also the decline in the prestige of science. And there is a related, also in certain academic circles, it has become now fashionable to say that science is just a social construct. So even though you have a community of scientists, it is no different from a community in a, you know, some cult, somehow trying to deprive science of its objectivity. So do you want to comment upon this trend towards interpreting science as a construction rather than an objective fact?
Well, if I hope that understood well your question, the point is that you should do some deep new. I mean, science is evolving. So the type of division in science that were valid half century ago are changing with time, and we have some different kind of scientific enterprises that are in the middle between. Mathematics and physics, sorry, between physics and biology, informatics and physics, and so on and so on. For example, all problem of learning is something that is related to neural network, but neural network, what it is, something that was born in biology because of the paper by Offield. It was studied by physics by the paper that Stefano, I think, mentioned on Amit Gottfried and Sompolinski. It went to informatics and so on. So it's artificial intelligence is something that is in the middle, and is something that requires a lot of different kind of contributions. Therefore, I think that it's nice to have some reflection or different way of teaching things to aggregate things. In some way, we could say that the science is something like a jacket, which is done by only one piece of tissue. And when you have a course at university, you cut a piece of the jacket, but that jacket has its own unity. So it's to try to preserve this unity of science is something that will be very important, and also to carry, to put different selection, different way to carry science discussion.
Okay. So if there are no further questions, I would like to thank both on behalf of CISA and ICTP, Giorgio. Okay, Stefano, I just want to make one quick announcement. Today also, after we in the afternoon, we have the Dirac Medal ceremony. And the two of the Dirac medalists, Professor Pierre Ramon and Professor André Nouveau, they are sitting in the first row. And Miguel Virasoro. And the third Dirac medalist for the year 2020 was our former director, Miguel Virasoro, who unfortunately is not with us. But there will be a ceremony in the afternoon and also in memoriam a session in the to honor the memory of Miguel Virasoro in the Budinich Hall. So thank you very much for coming.